Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Meeting will now come to order.
Okay.
At this time, I will call on Commissioner Vaughn for our invocation.
Let us pray. O God of all creation, we thank you for health sufficient to be here and for the respite from summer's heat. It is with thankful hearts that we lift our prayers to you. We ask you to protect in a special way those who are fighting for us today and for those who have fought for us in the past for the country we love. Bless them and take care of them. If they are tired, give them strength. If they are wounded and suffering, give them comfort. Grant them strength and wisdom and help them through your power and limitless love. We thank you for the life skill and dedication of those who served, and thank you for the sacrifice each of them has made for our nation. Lord, much of what we feel compelled to do is distasteful or disagreeable. Help us not to be impatient or unkind or disagreeable because we have distasteful things to do. Give us the tolerance and wisdom to do the right thing. We need your guidance in our efforts to do justice, mercy, and walk humbly with all your children. Amen.
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 If you have your cell phone, please turn them off because I need my phone.
All right.
Okay. At this time, I will start the public comment, and I ask that you don't speak any longer than 3 minutes, okay? And if it gets too long, what I'll do is move half of them to the second half of the meeting because we need to get on with our business part. And it's pretty long tonight, so I will certainly let everybody speak that wants to speak. If we have to split it up, then I will stop at the first half, and then the second half will be at the after our business meeting, okay? Marie Velotti?
Yes,
and you will be timed, and Ms. Hook, when you hear the bell, you need to quit.
Okay. When should I start?
Now.
Good evening. My name is Marie Velotti. My family and I moved to the Graham community in 1975. We started Interstate Nero Fabrics in 1985. Our business is located a few hundred feet from Stericycle. We have approximately 100 employees. And during our 25 years in business, we have contributed millions of dollars in community payroll and tax money. As a business owner, I understand the need to make a profit to stay in business. We are here this evening because we are concerned about one of our neighbors, who is not the responsible neighbor we would prefer to have living next to us. That neighbor is Stericycle. Its smokestacks are visible from Interstate 85 and 40. What is emitted from these smokestacks is a very wide range of toxic and carcinogenic chemicals. They include mercury, cadmium, furans, dioxins, lead, nitrogen oxides, chlorine, and many, many other heavy metals and particulate matter. These air pollutants have been linked with asthma, chronic bronchitis, lung cancer, and cardiovascular problems. We already have too many cancers in Alamance County. Records show that in Alamance County, cancer cases are 226 times the expected number of 1 in a million. We are breathing these carcinogens and heavy metals every day. We are in this area. All of us are breathing them now. According to the information I have obtained, in 2009, Stericycle had operating profits of over $300 million. It paid county taxes of $2,399 that year and Graham property taxes of $2,053. This is less than I paid just in residential taxes, never mind the taxes on the commercial property. I do not have a problem with a company that is in business of making profits, and I'm all for a company paying its legal taxes, no matter how minuscule they are in relation to its assets and profits. Those are not the major issues tonight. What I am thoroughly opposed to is a company that does not have its neighbor's health in mind. 4 years is too long to wait for cleaner air. I believe that Stericycle must be required to install whatever filters, scrubbers, and other machinery is needed to reduce its output of these carcinogens, heavy metals, and particulates to the lowest levels current technology will allow. The sooner, the better. They can do that, but only with your help. Thank you.
And next is Debbie Cook.
Hi, my name is Debbie Cook. I'm a retired Alamance County teacher and an area resident. I am here to talk to you today about our health and to ask you to do whatever you can to protect it. We all know that pollution is a threat to our health, and I am learning more and more about a group of very toxic chemicals called dioxin and the harm that they cause. Dioxin does not break down in the environment. It is released into the air when plastics and other wastes are burned. It falls to the ground and into the rivers. It is eaten by fish and cattle and enters our food chain. It is not metabolized by humans, and it accumulates in our fat cells. There is no threshold dose. The tiniest amount can cause damage to us, like cancers. And our bodies have no defense against it. The EPA recognizes this danger and has worked for over the last 20 plus years to reduce the creation and the release of this man-made chemical into our environment, and you all have too. In 2000, the number one source of dioxin was backyard burning of trash, and the number two source was medical waste incineration. Alamance County now bans the backyard burning of trash, so the number one source of this dangerous pollutant must be medical waste incineration. And we have two incinerators right here at Stericycle. I and many others ask you to please do what you can do to protect us from this dangerous pollution. Send a message to the state for us. Sign or adopt that resolution that requires Stericycle to come into compliance with the new EPA pollutant standards at least by 2012. Please don't expose us to 4 more years of this danger. Dioxin is released up in the form of particles, and we all know from elementary school that what goes up must come down. So thank you.
Thank you. Edwina, go ahead.
Hello. My name is Edwina Haddad, and I'm a longtime resident of Alamance County. I understand that Stericycle has met the legal requirements to have their burning permit renewed, and that this meeting is a mere formality to confirm the two current incinerators in operation here in Alamance County. What I don't understand is how come I cannot burn a pile of leaves within the city of Burlington, yet Stericycle is allowed to have uncontrolled emissions during bypass events. When the incinerator is malfunctioning, the bypass stack is opened and toxic air contaminants are released directly into the air with no pollution controls. The vast majority of these bypass events are allowed under the current operating permit and are not considered a violation by the state. There's no telling how much toxic chemicals are being released, and I'll reference the person preceding me. Here's what we can do to change that. I'm asking members of the Alamance County Commissioners to join Mecklenburg, Chatham, and Orange counties by passing this resolution before you tonight for incinerators to come into compliance with the new EPA rule by 2012. I'm asking Stericycle to commit to upgrading their facility and begin using autoclave systems to handle medical waste in a more environmentally friendly manner. The medical industry is already leading the way to eliminate waste. Did you know that Injects Equidyne Systems has developed a new needle-free drug injection method called Injex. Injex is reusable, needle-free medication injector that uses spring technology to deliver medication subcutaneously in the fatty tissue under the skin without the use of a needle. Wouldn't you agree that this is a great step forward in helping to eliminate medical waste? With each of us doing our part, we can affect the quality of the air we breathe here in Alamance County. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Sue Isley.
My name is Sue Isley. My husband is Max, and we have lived in Haw River since 1962. We live on Haywood Street, which is less than a mile from Stericycle. I want to thank you for the opportunity to come and speak with you. All of us here tonight are pro-Alamance County. We made a choice to live here. We made a choice to make this our home. My request to each of you is for you to pass the resolution as if you, your children, and your grandchildren lived across the street from Stericycle. We voted all of you guys in as commissioners, and we're trusting you with our help. Thank you. Oh, one more thing. I'm not quite up on time. I have gotten a petition signed by 63 of the residents on our street and in our neighborhood, and they all are asking for the same thing, that the resolution be passed.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Carol Thompson.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Carol Troxler. My husband George and I have lived in Alamance County for most of our lives. We live on Amick Road between Ossipee and Elon. I'm a historian, but you see, I keep up with the latest technology here. And I want to request that you add the Alamance County voice as one of the two North Carolina counties where the incinerators are actually located. The company owning the Haw River incinerator is the patent holder and provider for a far cleaner alternative called electrothermal deactivation. Stericycle has used ETD commercially for 20 years. I quote their company history. It eliminates human pathogens in medical waste product without producing dangerous emissions or liquid effluents, and it allows for the recycling of plastics from medical waste products. And I'll go back and repeat that they say that it eliminates human pathogens. That is what is known as pathogenic waste as distinct from simple medical waste. Already for a decade, Stericycle has been shifting away from incineration. Some states and local governments will not permit it. The narrowing of permit areas is not the only reason why the Haw River incinerator is a big money maker, however. Stericycle makes it easy for nearby hospitals and other waste providers to not separate pathogenic medical waste, which does require extra high temperatures, either from ETD or an incinerator, to separate that from regular medical waste, which does not require such a high temperature. That is contrary to what Stericycle promises their customers. They say they help waste providers minimize and separate their waste streams. And no doubt they do this in some places. They are required to do this in some places. Good for them, but they're not doing it here. And it is, my point is that this policy is contrary. It's foreign to the actual practices that the company encourages in North Carolina. Here, they can use that fuel of regular medical waste to save operating costs in the Haw River incinerator. Everybody knows now that burning paper and plastic is a highly toxic operation, even without the medical content. I'd like to know how important this practice is as a fuel-saving measure. Will compliance to the new standards cost them money whenever that compliance comes? Yes, of course it will. The good news is that Stericycle has plenty of money to invest. In March of 2009, when the recession was well underway, the CFO of Stericycle told Barron's, and I quote, "We aren't seeing any impact from the economic slowdown." In 2010, their first quarter revenues were up by 19%. Their income from operations, and that's where we are, for that same period from first quarter of 09 to first quarter 10, that operations profit increased by 17%.
What time is it?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Eric Henry. You be careful.
Good evening. I'm Eric Henry, and as of October this fall, we lived in Alamance County 50 years. I've also been president of TS Designs for over 30 years, a manufacturer here in Burlington, North Carolina. I first want to compliment somewhere in this room are the representative for Stericycle for running a very successful, profitable company. But a for-profit corporation has only one focus, to maximize return for their shareholders. The responsibility of government is to protect the citizens of their community. Corporations without regulations will give us what we had with the Wall Street meltdown and the disaster in the Gulf. Stericycle has both the money and the resources to comply with these new regulations. So first, I would like to request Stericycle look beyond their bottom line to meet these new regulations. But I also would request our county commissioners protect the citizens of Alamance County and pass this resolution. I would like to yield the rest of my time for the rest of our supporters tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. Judy Mulcran. And I believe you tried to contact me.
Yes, I did.
And I cannot call your number. It says...
That's Verizon. Yeah, it's been a four-month ordeal.
I have tried numerous times to call you on every phone I could find.
Well, I appreciate your effort. Thank you very much. Here's a magazine that's published locally. It's called Edible Piedmont. It has nothing to do with any type of fallout that's going to hit our crops. I have concerns and objections to the current weak standards for Stericycle's two hospital medical and infectious waste incinerators, their toxic and hazardous emissions. Please acknowledge that clean air, water, and soil in Alamance County and the surrounding areas are within your responsibilities and depend upon your decisions. Please send to the state the 2012 resolution, which expedites the adapting more strict emission guidelines by the EPA, which reduces pollution limits allowable from hospital medical infectious waste incinerators. Please send this resolution for the persons who have been rushed to the ER, having fears of an untimely death or disability, who have been or will be diagnosed with a disease, or who have a chronic disease which will have negative impact both on them and their families, destroying hopes and plans for their lives, creating difficulties, painful struggles, and decisions, and financial problems. Please send this resolution for parents with children diagnosed with dread medical conditions, for seniors with accumulations of pollutants and hazardous elements in their bodies and their brains, Alzheimer's, for pregnant women who only care about the health of their new baby, for persons with allergies, skin disorders, MS, multiple chemical sensitivity syndrome, COPD, CHF, cancer, immunosuppression, asthma, heart disease, or inflammatory processes. The fact that Alamance County has a 226% rate above the base guideline for cancer in population is not acceptable. Why should Stericycle continue to have such a negative impact on our health, air, water, and soil needed to grow and support our food? How far do the toxic emissions of gases, soot, particulates, carcinogens, mutagens, and various chemical compounds travel in our air on a sunny, light, breezy day, on a windy day, in the rain? When and where do they fall to the earth? Or on us? What is their structure? What is their weight? Who is in favor of these menacing dangers? Businesses, the state, other states, stockholders? Who will allow medical and hospital infectious incineration to create a Superfund air pollution in North Carolina's wonderful Piedmont? I cannot believe you will look us in the eye and say, "No, we don't care. We won't help you." I don't believe that y'all will do that. Please be thoughtful, respectful, and conscientious as your decision impacts your
constituency, the citizens of Alamance County, the health and well-being of thousands. With gratitude, thank you. I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sue
Layton. Good evening, Commissioners. Thank you for another opportunity to come and speak to you tonight about Stericycle Medical Waste Incinerator. My name is Sue Dayton. I live in Alamance County. Yes, I work for an environmental organization. I also teach art classes to children, and I am a small business owner in Saxbaha. Alamance County has been very good to Stericycle. In 2008-2009, Stericycle generated over $300 million in profits. In return, what do we get? We get medical waste from 22 states. Many of these states don't allow incineration of this waste in their own state. There's no incentive for Stericycle to switch to a cleaner alternative such as autoclaving. Although it's done this in three other states, it's removed its incinerators and replaced them with autoclaves. The air pollutants from Stericycle pose a risk to our most vulnerable populations, such as children and seniors. And it also pollutes our rivers and streams. And I won't go into all of the various illnesses and diseases it causes, because many have already done that tonight. So tonight, I want to ask you one last time, please, to join several other counties, cities, and towns to request that all medical waste incinerators in North Carolina come into compliance with the new and more protective EPA rules by 2012. Right now, as we sit here tonight in this meeting, Stericycle is releasing lead levels 5.5 times the new EPA standards and mercury levels 10.5 times the new EPA standards. Do we really want this to go on for another 4 years? We are simply asking you to join us in requesting that we let it go on for 2 years. 2 years. I don't think that's too much to ask. I really don't. And these numbers are confirmed. I'm going to give you an email tonight from Ray Stewart, who's an environmental engineer with the Division of Air Quality. Ray has confirmed these numbers tonight, and I will give you this in an email tonight. This is just not happening in Alamance County. Another incinerator in Mecklenburg County, this is Stericycle's competitor, by the way, is releasing levels of mercury, dioxins, and hydrogen chloride far beyond the new EPA standards. We have a moral responsibility. We have a responsibility as parents and as residents of Alamance County to not let this happen in Alamance County or in Mecklenburg County or in any county. In April, a letter was sent to the State Division of Air Quality Director, Keith Overcash, from Mr. Don Willard, who's a director of Air Quality in Mecklenburg County. And I want to read this. There's three sentences from his letter, and I have a copy for you each tonight. The notice for the new EPA rules began on October 6, 2009. Mecklenburg County Air Quality believes that 2 years is adequate time for planning, designing, purchasing, and installing new equipment by medical waste incinerators. Requiring a compliance by October 2012 gives 3 years, one more than needed. So I give you this letter tonight for your review, and I hope that you will join Don Willard and the rest of the counties and cities and towns in signing on to the resolution. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Susan Harder.
Good evening. My name is Susan Harder. I've been a resident of Alamance County since 1986. I married a Hall River boy and raised my family here in Graham, and I'm not here to give you facts and figures. I know you've heard enough of those, but just from a personal perspective, a couple of months ago, my mother-in-law passed away. She had a terrible illness called pulmonary fibrosis. If you get on the website for that, you'll see that the main cause of pulmonary fibrosis is attributed to environmental or industrial pollution. My mother-in-law lived about half a mile from Stericycle. She lived there about 40 years. And I can't prove that it was the cause of her death, but Stericycle's going to be here tonight, and they're going to probably say that the emissions from their stacks are safe. I would like for them to prove to me that they didn't cause her death. The bypass events could have happened when she was out mowing or working in her flowers, and breathing in polluted air could have triggered the episode that caused her to start with this terrible disease. We love her. We miss her terribly. She was a wonderful Christian lady, and she died way too young. So, thank you.
Thank you, Susan.
Thank you, Susan. Reverend Kerr?
Hello, I'm Beverly Kerr. My husband Julius and I have lived here in Alamance County most of our lives. We have Storybook Farm, a small business, and we're concerned for the people that we care about, all the contaminants that are coming from Stericycle. Stericycle is one of the country's largest medical waste incinerators. Not only does it burn North Carolina waste, but it has waste trucked in from more than 20 other states. That's because those other states don't allow medical waste burning. They know the environmental consequences. Stericycle is making millions while compromising our health and our environment. Of course, Stericycle's toxic and unnecessary emissions impact the air, but also the water, the Hall River, and the fish. Many people are now eating Hall River's fish that contain unsafe levels of mercury. Where are the warning signs along our impaired rivers, streams, and lakes? Shouldn't we be concerned? Are all of North Carolina's waters impaired now? If you don't know the answer to that, you should find out. We do know that cancer among Alamance County residents is 226 times the acceptable EPA rate, according to our own Healthy Alamance reports. We know there are 22 daycare centers and 13 schools all around Stericycle. We all know that children are more susceptible to pollutants, and we know that we need to protect our children. Why? Why do we allow this type of unnecessary burning when so many others have banned it? Why can't Stericycle convert their incinerators to better methods, like autoclaving? They've done this in at least three other states when citizens' actions caused them to close their incinerators. I'd like to repeat that. Citizens' actions caused them to close their incinerators. I have joined an environmental group called Clean Air Now so that I can help stop this unnecessary incineration. I'm just curious, would you raise your hands if you want clean air now for yourself and for those you love? If your hand is up, you should join Clean Air Now and take action with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Mickey Cox.
Hi.
Hey, how are you?
I'm Mickey Cox. Mine will be short and sweet. I've lived here pretty much all of my life. These folks have pretty much said it all, and I stand behind them. I think that you could do one thing, look up the dioxins, and see how dangerous they are, and you'll know. Thank you.
Thank you, Mickey.
Vic Euless.
Madam Chairman, members of the commission. Tim, how you doing?
Sure.
I'd like to speak to you people tonight as a citizen of Graham, not a councilman, not a has-been mayor or anything else, but. I've known of Stericycle since the early 90s. I'm fully aware of what the Clean Air Act is and what it requires our air to be for our citizens. This company has done, I think, its dead level best to try to comply. It has stated many times, as far as, you know, anytime they've had something to go awry, they have never denied that. They've made every effort as far as in straightening these things out. City of Graham's the same way, as far as when we have a water spill with our wastewater treatment plant. Nobody is perfect, but everybody strives to be as good as they can. I share a lot of the desires and wishes of the people who have spoken. But when the state and the federal government regulations are being met, being carried out by this company in good faith here in this county, I feel they are a good business in this county. I think they are very responsible to the county that they reside in, the city that they reside in, and I think they try to do a very good job for the citizens who live here. If you've been down to the facility, and I have on many occasions, if you see what goes on, you'll see that it's run in a very business and professional manner. The people will open their doors. I'm sure you're going to get a good presentation tonight. They'll open their doors to you at any time, as long as and as well as with the other citizens who are here, who have really strong concerns about their air. But I don't want to see the people down there do anything wrong. I don't want to see their people out of a job. I don't want to see, as far as the tax revenues, as far as diminished. I don't want to see our people unemployed. I think this business has, is, and will be run in a correct and business and timely manner. And I'd like to let you know that I support those actions that they carry out. Thank you.
Thank you. I hear comments from the audience, and that is not allowed. Nobody has made any comments whatsoever against your group, Ms. Dayton. So please don't make any comments just for the one that is talking for Stericycle.
Chairman Massey, I wasn't saying anything.
I know you weren't, but I'm just saying. It was next to you and I heard it. There will be no more comments like that from the audience, okay? So, because that's just not fair. So, okay, the next.
I've got to leave, but I would consider that source that just came from.
Thank you, sir. I'm going to go on. Sedona Fisher. Well, I'm going to try to get through with this now rather than move it. I got nine more. Where is she?
She's done.
Okay.
Yeah, let it, because unless you're going to put the Stericycle behind the.
Hello, I'm Sedona Fisher. I'm 10 years old. I'm also very concerned about all the littering that is and has happened. Me and my friend have started an Earth Club to help our Earth. We had a parade on my street about littering. We are planning on having another parade again sometime soon. I wrote a letter to the President of the United States about the oil spill. He hasn't written back yet, but I'm hoping he will soon. On Saturdays, I go to a farmer's market in Saxon Hall. There, I make and sell earrings. Some of this money I am planning on donating to some place that is helping with the oil spill. I am really sad that I'm growing up in a place that has terrible things in the air that I am breathing in. I'm here speaking because this is very serious what is happening. People and animals getting sick because of the air we breathe in is not right. We should not have this problem. Stericycle is making this horrid problem grow and grow by burning more and more medical waste, and which making a nasty habitat for everyone. Thank you.
I've got to know who your friend is.
Thank you.
What's your friend's
Saki.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Good evening. My name is Gretchen Fisher. My husband and my children and I live in Graham. I'm a local school teacher in Alamance County. My children both attend school here. And in the past 5 to 10 years, the population of Alamance County has grown tremendously. And as the population continues to grow, the leaders of this county are charged with a great responsibility. Rather than citing empirical data or telling you personal stories, I just have a question for you to consider in your decision making. Exactly what type of community are we creating for the future? Are we creating one that is best serving the needs of business, or are we creating a place that is best for our children? Thank you.
Katie Nunn.
Hi there. My name is Katie Nunn. I live in Saxville Hall. This is my son, Braden. We are just beginning to scratch the surface of the horrific effects that toxins and chemicals are having on our health and our environment. And as a family union unit, we decided to move to Saxville Hall to join a community that is really consciously trying to make better choices on the food we eat and the products we buy. And as a consumer and a parent, I have a choice to choose the cleaner household cleaners and detergents and organic foods. But my son and everyone else, we don't have a choice on what air we breathe. And companies such as Stericycle have a responsibility to make these choices for us, to put the tightest restrictions of compliance.
Mommy, I want to speak on a microphone.
What do you want to say? Say,
please keep my ear clean.
Please get my hair clean.
we cannot do this soon enough. I mean, tomorrow is not soon enough. And this is an investment in our children. Thank you.
Julie
McAteer. Hi, I'm Julie McAteer. I'm 39 years old, and I was born and raised in Alamance County. I'm an 11-year cancer survivor, have a 4-year-old son, and I work very hard to be as healthy as I possibly can. I raise a lot of money for Relay for Life, and I've lost a lot of friends and family due to cancer. And I'm astounded that in the year 2010, we can have a company who is allowed to do this. Just, you know, kind of going by what she said, I should have a choice to breathe clean air. My son has a choice. For 11 years, I've worked very hard, and I've worked very hard to have him, and now he's 4. I think it's the only responsible thing for Stericycle to do is use their other healthy alternative that they do have in place and protect us all here in Alamance County. Thank you.
Carolyn Cole.
My name is Carolyn Cole. I thank you for the opportunity to speak with you. I'm an area resident. A vote to support the 2012 deadline is not an anti-business vote. It is a vote that says we promote clean air industries in Alamance County. I know that Alamance County must be positive toward industry to attract jobs. I read that Microsoft is considering coming to Alamance County, which should be a very big plus. I hope that they do. But as they look at the environment for their workers, will they be impressed by the presence of an incinerator that burns medical waste for almost half the states in the country? Will they factor that in as a positive? I don't think so. Now consider that that same incinerator facility, but being converted to a safer, non-burning alternative, like an autoclave or like the advanced technology that Stericycle has in other places that is within their own patent. Stericycle has made this conversion in at least 3 cities already. with employees keeping their jobs. So we can convert from incineration to something else. There are a number of possibilities, and people will keep their jobs. Consider the possibility that the Alamance County Commissioners could encourage such a conversion. That conversion from incineration to a safer technology would be seen by Microsoft, other businesses that may want to locate in Alamance County, and voters as a plus, a real plus, and a win-win situation for Alamance County. Voting to strengthen air standards in Alamance County by voting for the 2012 deadline will benefit all of us. And coupled with a vision to convert incineration to a safer alternative will save jobs and enhance Alamance quality of life. Thank you.
Thank you.
Carvady.
Chairman Massey, members of the board, I appreciate this opportunity to speak with you this evening. You've heard a lot, and largely the comments have been about one resolution. I know you've got four resolutions before you this evening. I'm interested in all four of those, but as you can see, I do support the resolution in favor of increased standards for Stericycle. I think inquiring minds want to know what's coming out of these Stericycle stacks. We know that there's water vapor. That's part of the process. But what's involved? What else is coming out? If it was only water vapor, we wouldn't be having this conversation tonight. That's why, you know, this is toxic waste we're talking about. This is hazardous waste. And corporations have no heart, soul, mind, or conscience. Bottom line, profit is their motive. And therefore, the government that has created these corporations has to be the conscience, has to regulate these corporations. And that's what we're here for. That's what we're asking you to do. As our elected officials, we're asking you to bring reasonable standards. And I don't find this resolution unreasonable. It's not like there are not alternatives. Stericycle has alternatives. They're very profitable, and maybe they need to spend a bit of that profit to protect the citizens living here in Alamance County. I brought my family here in 83. I've got 11 grandchildren, and I hope to have great-grandchildren, and I'm concerned about what we're leaving generations to come. I understand that, you know, mercury, cadmium, lead, dioxins, when we put these into the environment, they don't just go away. They're there. What are we leaving for our grandchildren, great-grandchildren? And something for you to consider, five members of the board here, we're asking you what I think is a reasonable resolution. I just pray that you'll support it tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Michael Holland.
Thank you, Commissioner Massey. As members of the business community, we all agree that our economic development potential is directly correlated with the quality of life, the perception of quality of life in our community. So the question before the board tonight is not whether you're going to vote for this resolution or not, and therefore harm this particular company, Stericycle, and their bottom line. I think the question before the board is whether or not you're going to harm our image in Alamance County, our brand. and therefore harm the economic development potential of the entire business community that you serve. I think more importantly, not passing this resolution makes it more difficult to attract high-tech industry. CBS just put out a survey. They said we're number 4 in the nation as a state in attracting new relocations. And those companies are primarily innovative companies, innovation companies, high-tech companies, and they bring a high-paid worker, a highly trained worker. That's a clean tax company that we want in this county. And when companies consider relocating to our county, it's resolutions such as the one that you will pass tonight that I think helps build our brand in Alamance County. I think by passing this resolution, you'll protect our future economic development potential. I hope I've linked those two. And I've worked hard on the Haw River Trail. That gentleman just walked out of here, ex-Mayor Euless, and I paddled down that river, and I took his wife down the river. She went in the front of my boat. He went with a famous paddler. We got a lot of press on that. We've been working on it hard for quality of life indices so people can look at our county and say, this is a great place to live. Great people, great quality of life. Let's move our company there. Let's put our people there. Our VPs are going to want to know what's in the newspaper. And when these press, when this media, hey, Aaron, Tom, when y'all go home and y'all print this, just by printing it, just by having this discussion here, just by allowing this company to come here, and Ms. Hoboy's here, she's a brave woman, she's come back twice now in the teeth of our resistance. But I don't think you can get around the argument. It's protecting one company's bottom line at the expense of all the rest in Alamance County. That company sits on the interstate. Let's bring those smokestacks down. Let's take the time it takes. Let's work with this company so they can switch to a cleaner technology, one that has a good public image. And we'll sell that on the interstate every day to everyone that passes our county. Thank you so much for your time.
Okay, thank you. Any other
visual? I got your name wrong. The J is more like a Y. I think you pronounced it with the J, so it's okay. It's all good.
Three times I should have got it wrong.
I think you had it last time, last meeting. So, first of all, thank you again for the opportunity for opening this up for the chance for several concerned citizens. I don't know if you saw the overflow room, but there is a fairly large audience in there as well. This obviously is a topic that is top of mind for several people, and I can speak on behalf of another 20 people that wanted to come but had conflicts tonight. That said, I've approached you in the past from the perspective of a children's advocate, as a mother of a 9-year-old and a 6-year-old. And as a resident of 14 years in Alamance County. Tonight, I'm going to talk to you from the perspective as a business owner and entrepreneur. I was raised in an entrepreneurial family. I own an art education company here in Alamance County. I employ 14 employees. I'm pro-business. I'm a Republican. I'm proud to admit that. And I say that because of the fact that I had a very strong sense from several people on this commission group that maybe there was a feeling that industry was under attack. That is not what we are talking about here whatsoever. I'm not looking to try to put this company out of business. I am pro-business, and I want to make that very clear. But when I was pursuing my MBA at Kenan Flagler Business School, the sole goal of any corporation, you learn this on day one, UNC, Chapel Hill, is that the sole goal of a corporation is profit maximization. So, Mr. Lashley, when you said, well, maybe the company will just do this on their own, sorry, but that's in direct conflict with that sole goal of profit maximization. They're not going to do it. It's not because they don't want to be good citizens, but here's the thing. They're a publicly traded company. They have quarterly releases of their financial information, and shareholders follow that very closely, and they buy or sell based on that. So they're not looking to spend additional money that they do not need to spend. Additionally, in all good business schools, there's a focus on taking an ethics course. And the reason they do that is because of the fact that as a business, you are looking to maximize profit, shareholder wealth, and profit maximization, that this often will come into conflict with other things, like in this case, the well-being and health of the environment. And I'd like you to keep that in account. Take that into account. So I want to approach this from the perspective of risk-reward. This is a company that county taxes paid $2,399, Graham taxes of $2,053. I, as a personal individual in Alamance County, paid higher than both of those taxes. That doesn't even include what kind of business taxes I pay. So that's the first point in terms of what kind of reward that they offer. Additionally, I know they employ 30 people. You heard from Marie, she employs 100 people. We can go through the list of the people that have come in front of you and add up the numbers of employees that they represent with their businesses. I will tell you, if change does not occur with this, I would not have an issue about moving my family and moving my company out of this county, and I'll tell you why. As an individual that is aware of the dangers of this business in medical waste incineration, I have to do what's best for my family, and I ask each of you to make the decision that's in the best interest of citizens, children, and business owners, and hold them accountable. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dave York.
Good evening, folks. I'm one of the overflow people that Heather just mentioned. My name is Dave Bjork, and it's nice to see you again. Thank you for some time. Politically speaking, there's a misperception that anyone who supports environmental issues comes from the far left. Like Heather, I am fairly conservative in my ideological endeavors, registered Republican, and I do support business as well. However, this issue extends far beyond politics, race, gender, and age. This is about what's doing the right thing for the citizens of our county, particularly those who can't protect themselves, being young children, seniors, the infirmed, etc. When my family and I moved here in 1996, we strived to provide the greatest possible environment and opportunity for our family for years and years to come. We could have lived anywhere between the Triangle and Greensboro because I had a job opportunity here in Burlington. After weighing all the neighborhoods, the school districts, the opportunities for leisure, we selected Burlington as a place to live. We believed we made the right choice. However, as Heather said just before me, I don't know if we would make that same choice today. We are very concerned about the air that we breathe, the environment, the attitudes of business around us. And I want to apologize to you all. I had an opportunity to speak. I listened. I was at the last meeting. I came away just based on comments and banter back and forth that you all didn't necessarily care about the citizens as much as you do about the businesses that provide taxes for our county. Again, I apologize because I think I was a little quick to make a decision and a little unfair in that. However, the more I learn about Stericycle and the amount of people that they employ here in the area and the amount of taxes that they pay, I mean, that's certainly not the case. The more I hear about the pollutants and the dioxins that are pumped into the air, again, like I said, the more concerned I get. I know you wanted to take some time and come up and weigh the issues a little bit and get more information. And I certainly hope that the information that you may have garnered between the last meeting and now via emails, by speakers, I hope you're getting that information to do what many of us think is the right thing by adopting the resolution or supporting the resolution as the other counties, Mecklenburg, Orange, and Chatham, have already passed, and speak for the people who can't speak for themselves. Pass the resolution to the stricter standards by 2012. Show us who voted for you and hope to vote for you again that you support our causes and our issues and do the right thing. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, that's the last one. But I want to urge all of you guys to stay and watch the Stericycle presentation. She does have a presentation tonight, and I do urge you to stay and watch that. At this point, I'm going to open the public hearings on Community Development Block Grant, 2007 Scattered Site Project Closeout, and Community Development Block Grant Application. Mr. Martin.
Good Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening, and I will be very brief tonight. First, I have an item here for the 2007 Scattered Site CDBG closeout, Community Development Block Grant closeout. In 2007, the county was awarded a $400,000 grant to do full housing rehabilitation for low to moderate income residents in the county. You should have in your packet a memorandum from me explaining this. I do want to add a little clarification to the memo. We did nine houses, full rehabilitation on nine houses in the county. Eight of those houses were specifically done with CDBG funds, but we also levy home energy loan pool funds through Duke Energy. And with that, we were able to do an extra house. That's why it reflects nine houses there, but actually eight were done with the CDBG funding. Recently, the Department of Commerce Division of Community Assistance came in and audited and monitored that grant and found no problems with it. Everything was in order, and the Planning Department is prepared to close the grant out at this time. There's really no action or vote that needs to be taken by the board tonight. With your consensus, we'll go ahead and begin the closeout on that.
Okay.
And the second public hearing tonight, this is for just every year when, before we can actually apply for CDBG funding, we have to hold what's called a generic public hearing. And the purpose of the hearing is just to receive citizen input regarding the use of community development block grant funds. In the memo that you should have in your packet, I've explained what we can use these funds for. First is community revitalization projects, including housing rehab, clearance, relocation, infrastructure improvements, and recreational improvements. There's also an infrastructure improvement grant, which could be used for water and or sewer improvements. Housing development projects, which is for funding for the development of new low to moderate income housing. An example of that would be the recent project we did with partnering with Habitat for Humanity, which we should be closing that out fairly soon as well. Infrastructure and improvement projects to promote economic development. And then also scattered site housing projects, which could include housing rehabilitation, clearance, and relocation. All of these programs are designed for the benefit of low to moderate income citizens. No vote or action is required other than just to receive public input at this time. And I'll be glad to take any questions you all have on any of those grants.
No, I called Jason and I was I got bogged down with the recreational improvements, and you explained that you're working with Brian, and more things can come back into Alamance County because y'all working together.
Mm-hmm.
You two or other departments too, and I think that's fantastic.
Yeah, absolutely. I work very closely with Brian Haygood, and specifically we had looked at a project area last year for a community revitalization project, which at the time allowed up to $1 million grant if you did something that was innovative, and that would be to, say, create a small community park or a recreation center, something like that. But it has to be tied in with housing improvements and infrastructure improvements as well in the community. It's really designed to just completely revitalize that area. But yeah, we work very, very, very closely with Brian and his staff and try to partner up and match funding and get creative as we can get.
We thank you for what y'all do. Thank you.
Thank you, Jason.
Okay, now I will call on Ms. Hoboy. And she is next on my agenda, am I not right? Oh, at this time I need to close the public hearing. I'm sorry. So, did I hear motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
All right, everybody in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Okay, now, Celine Hoboy. And John, is that right? Jim, I was close.
Do you have it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Celine, before you start, this is not a public hearing, so we're not going to have questions from the audience for them. If you got any, you can call them after this, and I think they'll be glad to help you with that. The commissioners, if they have any questions, we can ask them. Most of us have been down there, but this is not a public hearing for Stericycle. So just want to reiterate that tonight, okay?
Sorry, we're just going to wait to make sure that the presentation's up.
Yes. Here comes the guru.
Celine, can we get your contact number in that case so that if we do have questions, like she said, Chairman Massey was very kind to let us call you, but we won't know how. Is there a contact number you could give everyone before you get started?
You can contact Stericycle, and
it's hard to get through to you. I mean, your job is. Well,
I'm all over the place, but.
And you're going to speak tonight, so we actually want to ask you the questions and ask you specifically about these comments. So, is there a phone number? Can we get a phone number, like you said?
Sure, we'll get you one.
We'll get you one.
Before your presentation is over.
Sure.
Or after it's over, we'll get you one.
Well, I'd like to get the record.
Okay.
Commissioners and Madam Chairman Massey, thank you for providing Stericycle the opportunity to present this evening. My name is Celine Hoboy, and I'm the Vice President of Legislative and Regulatory Affairs. I'm here presenting with me tonight is Mr. Jim Nold, who also works with us on engineering and capital design projects. I've been with Stericycle for 10 years, and prior to this role, I was the Vice President for Environmental Safety and Health for the company. I'm also the Chairman of the Healthcare Waste Institute. I'm here before you tonight, and I recognize that you have a resolution that you've been asked to approve. This resolution calls for the adoption of the new clean air standards for hospital medical infectious waste incinerators, which were promulgated in October of 2009, into the state of North Carolina Department of Environmental and Natural Resources, or DENR, 2 years before the federal timetable of 2014. I'm here tonight to provide you with information about Stericycle, the facility in Haw River and in the city of Graham, where we run a hospital medical infectious waste incinerator, which will be impacted by these regulations, so that you may make an informed decision about the resolutions before you. In overview, our presentation will provide a brief information about the company, the Haw River facility, the incinerator process, and finally, the current status of the regulations. Our goal here is to inform the Commission and the public, as we've heard from many in the community who have either questions or misconceptions about what we do at Haw River. In the interest of time, as I see you have a very busy agenda this evening, I was hoping to get through the entire presentation as expeditiously as possible so that we can get done and then you can answer questions at the end. Stericycle was born out of regulations in 1989. In the mid-80s, there were several incidents of regulated medical waste washing up on the shores of New Jersey and along the eastern seaboard. EPA became very concerned and implemented the Medical Waste Tracking Act. Though that act has since expired, states including North Carolina moved towards ensuring that these wastes did not present a public safety risk, promulgated regulations regarding the proper treatment and disposal of these materials. Today, Stericycle has grown to have a global presence of over 8,000 employees with 440,000 customers, and we service a wide range of customers from small doctor's offices to rural facilities, as well as large institutions such as research facilities and hospitals. We work with our customers to protect people and reduce risk by combining integrated solutions with superior customer service, promoting safety, compliance, and risk management. To that end, we provide compliance services such as employee training, auditing for smaller facilities who may not have the resources to maintain safety professionals on site. And some of the services that many people are not aware of is our returns and recall business. We've provided recall services for hundreds of products which have to be taken off the market due to concerns about safety. Some of those would be like Tylenol, recently heard about in the news, and consumer products, even like dishwashers. We have environmental protection and safety at the core of our company values. We promote proper waste management, including waste segregation, recycling, and reuse. We have specialized programs available to customers to be able to reuse Sharps containers, for example. These types of containers you might see at your doctor's office when you get a shot, usually needles or a sharp objects that would be placed in these containers
which are now reusable. Meaning what we provide to the containers, we provide containers to the generators, they fill them, and then we bring them back to our facility, we decant the contents, and then we reuse by washing and disinfecting those containers and returning them to the generator, saving those single-use containers from going to the landfill. And to date, we've prevented over 82 million containers from being landfill, and that number is continuing to grow by the minute, which you can see via our continuous counter on the internet. We provide services to remove pharmaceutical waste, which are growing concern as emerging contaminants in the environment, by training generators about proper segregation and waste disposal requirements. And of course, as regulations have changed and the number of incinerators has been dramatically reduced in the last decade, we've worked with our customers to ensure proper segregation of their waste. This was reduced in the overall volume of incineration waste collected from over 30% to now 10%. We have over 100,000 customers on our special OSHA compliance program, which helps keep their facilities and their employees safe and compliant. We have over 400 employees working in hospitals and our customers, and we have 100 dedicated environmental and safety staff working together to ensure compliance and safety, both internally for our customers. So you see, compliance and the environment are very much part of our everyday existence. If it were not for the presence and the proliferation of regulations, we wouldn't be here as a company today. Speaking of regulations, as you can see, we have several agencies to deal with. We not only deal with local and state governments like the City of Graham and Diener, but we also work with federal regulations beyond EPA like DOT, OSHA, USDA, DEA, and FDA. As a consequence, we also have to ensure that our employees understand and adhere to those regulations. Just as an example, you can see we provide a very high level of training. Our people are extensively and repeatedly trained to understand and deal with all the issues as it relates to the waste that they're dealing with. To bring it to a more local level, the facility we run has been in its current location since the mid-1980s, and it's been in its current configuration with the two incinerators since 1990 when it was being run by BFI. Stericycle acquired the facility in 1999, and today we employ 172 employees in North Carolina, which includes our sales teams, management, staff working at our facilities, drivers, and those in the hospitals. We have 55 employees who report directly into Hall River every day, 39 of which are Alamance County residents. We also work with over 160 North Carolina-based vendors and work very hard to conduct our business with local vendors throughout our business. Our management team, who unfortunately could not be here tonight due to other engagements, are Bob Brown, who's the district manager for the Mid-Atlantic area, Dale Rich, who runs the operations for both North and South Carolina, Alan Skripsak, who's actually our Hall River plant manager himself, and then we have a safety and health manager, Craig Edwards, and an environmental manager, Kelly Roberts. As we get into this process, I think it's important that we all understand the type of waste we're talking about here that's treated at the facility. We take regulated medical waste, and while we're permitted to treat other waste, that is predominantly the majority of the waste we process here. It includes things like gloves and gowns and tissues that you'd expect to see at a doctor's office, or if you've ever watched shows like ER or Grey's Anatomy, you might have seen those on the ER or OR. But ultimately, these materials, which may have the potential of causing disease in humans and animals, are what we deal with. Sharps waste is presented a little differently, as this waste has the potential of penetrating or cutting the skin and must be packaged in special containers, like the Sharps containers I talked about earlier. Two wastes that are listed up there that we hear about a lot are pathological and trace chemotherapy. I wanted to address those because these are the keys to why incineration is still so important. There are 24 states which mandate some form of incineration for certain types of medical waste. For example, in North Carolina, pathological waste, such as mass tissue, amputations, biopsies, animals from veterinarians, labs, schools, must be incinerated or interred. However, many landfills are prohibited or choose to prohibit landfilling of these materials. The other key element is that not all the wastes are effectively treated by alternative methods. You've probably heard a lot about, and you have heard a lot about, autoclaving. Autoclaving is a process of decontaminating waste, the waste from infectious substances, or the bugs, if you will, through the use of steam. This waste is placed inside of a cylindrical vessel, and the vacuum is created and pressurized, and steam is introduced into the chamber, which brings the temperature to approximately 275 to 325 degrees Fahrenheit, and will sustain that for approximately 30 minutes to kill the pathogens. After the steam treatment, many of the materials in the waste are still fairly recognizable. It is a safe and effective means of killing pathogens for most sharps and soft wastes. However, it's not good at penetrating dense materials. Many times, pathological wastes are kept frozen so that they do not become putrescent while awaiting collection and disposal. Additionally, things like trace chemotherapy, and what I mean by that is they're materials that are used during the course of administering chemotherapy, like the IV tubing that might still contain a needle, the gauze pad, and those materials, not the bulk products or the jugs of the actual chemotherapy chemicals. These are not effectively treated in the autoclaving process. They may actually be altered in a way that may make it more harmful to the environment. This is also true about non-hazardous pharmaceuticals. In fact, recent information from the EPA states there's a misconception about autoclave and microwaves and that they do not destroy the compounds in question, and that proper incineration at high temperatures is an appropriate treatment method for these wastes. So incineration for these small portions of total medical waste stream is necessary. However, due to the expense and complexity of running an incinerator, and as we discussed, the regulations that passed in 1997 and most recently in 2009, there only remain a few incinerators to provide this function. And thus, they're located throughout the country to service the needs of our customers. For example, Haw River is part of a mid-Atlantic region, which comes from southern Pennsylvania through South Carolina. We have autoclaving facilities in Baltimore and Concord. We bring those wastes from those locations into Haw River, and then the other wastes are sent to our regional autoclaves. The numbers for this area are in general trending as we have nationwide, with about 10% of the waste that we collect going to incineration and 90% going to alternative treatment technology. You've heard tonight that we receive waste from half the country, and that's true only in part. We do provide backup in services for rare instances when our other facilities are down or for maintenance or repair, just as they provide a backup service for us. We do move waste back and forth out of the facilities based on the type of waste that there is. For example, waste that must be incinerated from Baltimore is placed on a trailer bound to Haw River. Once it gets here, we'll offload it, and things that can be autoclaved get put back onto the trailer for Baltimore. Lastly, you'll hear that autoclave facilities are underutilized and that they may have excess capacity. It is absolutely true that some of our autoclave plants have some additional capacity. A company would not build a multi-million dollar facility without room for growth over time. But it is incorrect and untrue to say that we're purposefully incinerating more waste than is needed in Haw River, or purposefully diverting waste from around the country to bring it here. Incineration is difficult and it is expensive. It would not be a sound business practice to spend more than necessary to manage these materials in an efficient manner. Again, Stericycle provides a complete range of collection disposal options as necessary for the healthcare community, and we are committed to providing that service while minimizing incineration to only that which is necessary. The next part of the slide talks about what we're not accepting at Haw River: chemicals, hazardous waste. I'll get to dental waste in just a minute. Radioactive waste, which we screen for, complete human remains, bulk chemotherapy, compressed gas cylinders, canisters, inhalers, aerosols, and other waste containing heavy metals. You may have heard that we have a history of mercury issues. Back in 2004, we did have an exceedance for mercury during a stack test. This resulted in the closer evaluation of the waste stream and our customer base. We worked closely with Diener to come up with a plan, and we identified the dental waste as a potential issue. We implemented a program that included educating our customers and staff and put in a plan to identify, segregate, the waste in a fail-safe system using both visual cues to the drivers and processors, but also a lockout of our waste handling system. Since that time, we've had no further issues with mercury emissions. Now I'll turn it over to Jim to walk you through the process at Haw River.
Thanks, Celine. Madam Chairwoman, members of the Commission, thank you for your time tonight. My name is Jim Nold. I manage capital improvements and facility support for Stericycle. It's my job to help engineer and manage the upgrades and the maintenance of our equipment to make sure that the operation of our plants is as efficient as it can be and stays in compliance. I'd first like to take you through a short description of how we typically operate. First, we pick up properly packaged and labeled containers at the customer and transport them back in route trucks per DOT regulations to our plant. There at the dock, we unload them by hand, as you see here. If you notice the small white labels on each container, this contains our proprietary BioTrack system. This is a barcode which our drivers scan with a handheld device called a PDT, which is similar to what you see the folks at UPS and FedEx use. This identifies the type of waste, the customer, and the time it was picked up. Once these containers are offloaded at the plant, they are scanned again at the processing scale and either conveyed into the incinerator or transferred onto another truck and trailer for transport elsewhere and treatment at one of our autoclave plants. Typically, as Celine said, this occurs at either our Concord facility, which is near Charlotte, or over at Baltimore. The scanning station here continues the tracking process from the origin at the generator through treatment and on to final disposal. We also capture important compliance data here as we monitor and control the waste feed rate to comply with our permitted pounds per hour. That permitted rate is around 1,900 pounds per hour. This is an overall plan view of the facility. It's a little bit difficult to see, but we've labeled some of the important pieces for you. You can see the dock area down at the bottom where waste is conveyed to the container scanning area. And then waste is then fed into the incinerator chambers by the conveyors. On the back side of the feed area are the air pollution control and wastewater treatment equipment up at the top of the plan sheet. And we'll describe that and all of this equipment in a little bit more detail coming up. As we said earlier, the site and the facility are very heavily regulated. Here are some of the permits under which we operate. We're regulated at every level, from the federal level to the state level to the local level, as we are at the City of Graham. The most important one of these, of course, and the one that's of greatest interest to all of you here tonight, is the air permit under Title V of the Clean Air Act. This permit specifically details how we must operate our equipment every minute of every day. In addition, we have a state solid waste permit dictating the acceptance and handling of waste and ash, under which we test our ash semi-annually and then it goes to a sanitary landfill. Currently, this material goes to the Piedmont landfill. Our compliance professionals review and audit the landfills we use to make sure they are properly equipped and that they too operate in compliance with all regulations. We have a wastewater permit from the City of Graham that addresses the treatment and discharge of our process water. Again, there's a misperception out there that we directly discharge our plant water into the Haw River. This simply is not true. We collect and treat our process water on site, and we treat it to remove solids, metals, chemicals, adjust the pH, and then we send it via sanitary sewer to the City of Graham treatment plant, where it is treated again to clean water standards. The city samples our water independently once per month to make sure that we stay in compliance with our permit and their ability to treat it. It's not necessary for us to have a stormwater permit because we've achieved a no discharge status. What that means is the state's evaluation says that we safely manage our waste and our process waters in such a way as to isolate them from rainwater and runoff. In other words, we do everything inside or undercover so we don't pose any risk to stormwater. Finally, you hear that we process foreign garbage at our site. This refers to a waste that's commonly called APHIS waste. APHIS stands for the Animal and Plant and Health Inspection Service. And that refers to waste that we're required to process by law from airplanes, cruise ships, the military, or other similar locations, which are classified by the government as posing a potential risk for untreated disposal because they may originate outside the U.S. It's mostly food and beverages, things that you would typically eat or drink on a plane or a cruise ship. The important thing to remember is that this waste type, this APHIS waste, comprises a very, very small part of what we do, usually less than 1% of what we take in. The incinerator process in general is comprised of combustion of wastes, pathogens, and gases in the primary and secondary, the cooling, conditioning, scrubbing, and control of exhaust gases in the air pollution control system, and the monitoring of these systems to ensure performance and compliance. I'd like to point out a couple of more things that have to do with these processes. First, we've heard that we don't test often enough. Even though we perform stack tests and exhaust sampling once per year by an independent third-party testing company, which is witnessed on site by the state, we are monitoring that equipment minute by minute the rest of the time through our computerized data acquisition system, which we refer to as our DAS. The settings on the machinery, such as temperature, pressure, flow rate, and pH, are recorded during a successful stack test, and these values are accepted by the state. Then we input these settings into the machine controls, and we monitor the equipment continuously with real-time readouts of these performance settings, or parameters as they're referred to in the regulations, to ensure that the incinerator and its emission control scrubbers are operating at or below these optimal compliance settings. At any time a single one of these parameters exceeds the permitted levels, the system locks out. Waste cannot be fed until the parameter is brought back within the permitted range. Again, all this information is continuously recorded. We submit it to the state, and it's available for public review. Lastly, we talked earlier about testing and monitoring that is required on our ash and our wastewater so that we ensure compliance in these areas as well. In short, virtually everything we do is permitted, tested, checked by an independent authority to make sure that the facility operates in accordance with applicable regulations. To describe the process a little bit further, this diagram represents the main features of the equipment in the incinerator and the air pollution control system and how they each work for specific purposes. To begin treatment, the waste is fed into the primary chamber, which, as Celine said, kills the pathogens or bugs and is destroyed at temperatures between 1200 and 1500 degrees. The wastes are incinerated here, leaving behind a small quantity of ash. From there, gases are produced during the burning, and they feed up into the secondary chamber, where the gases are heated up to between approximately 1800 to 2000 degrees. This is where dioxins and furans, which form during the initial combustion in the primary, are heated up to chemically break down and dissipate. From there, gases are fed into the quench and the absorber chambers, where they are water-cooled and caustic neutralized to eliminate acid gases like hydrogen chloride. Liquids from this area go on to the on-site wastewater treatment plant to be further treated, and gases move over to the Venturi chamber, where entrained particulates are removed. Finally, metals like cadmium and mercury are removed in the demister before the scrub gases and the water vapor are blown up the exhaust stack. Finally, you will note that above the secondary, on the left-hand side of the diagram there, you'll see something called the emergency relief vent. This is what's commonly called the bypass stack, and you've heard about that several times tonight. Let me explain the function of this feature. It exists, as the name suggests, to serve as a vent to be used in the event of an unexpected upset of the operation, such as a power outage or an equipment malfunction. If something like this happens, it's essential to the safety of our workers, the plant, and the surrounding community to have this vent to open and relieve the pressure that would otherwise build up in the machinery and pose an explosion risk. When this happens, we shut down the burners, the machines are immediately locked out, and waste cannot be fed into the incinerator until the situation is resolved. This happens very rarely. Let me give you an example. Last year, there were a total of 5 bypass events, 5. 3 of these events were due to power outages from the local utility. We have no control over the local power company's operations, obviously, but we have taken steps to put in place a backup generator on site to take over when the power goes out. Even so, there's still a matter of a few seconds before the generator can come up to speed. The power remains off during this time, and then the bypass stack must remain open. Going forward, we're looking at ways to speed up this reaction time so that we can avoid bypasses from power outages in the future. Those are three of the five. The other two events that occurred last year were for equipment malfunctions. One was a pump failure on our absorber, and the other was a pressure reading overage. A couple important points to keep in mind here. First, we operate this plant 24/7, 365. Taking into account downtime for maintenance, this amounts to over 16,000 hours a year, including both units. The total time of our five bypass events last year was 25 minutes total. It's about 0.03 of a percent of our operating hours. Second, it's been misstated that the use of the bypass stack is unmonitored. This is not true. The stack cap is continuously monitored and its position is recorded in our computerized DAS. We record and we report each bypass event to the state, describing the time, the duration, the cause, and any corrective action taken to repair equipment. Finally, if you drive past the plant, there may be other times when you'll see the cap in an open position. These are during periods of downtime when we perform maintenance on the equipment. This occurs regularly, about once a month. And even though we run 24/7, machines can't run forever without downtime for maintenance. Again, keep in mind, during these downtimes, no waste is being fed and the burners are off. So, with all this technology, how are we doing? We've heard a lot tonight about certain pollutants of concern: mercury, dioxin, particulates. Here are some examples of our performance from recent stack tests in controlling these emissions. What we've shown here is our current and most recent stack tests in light blue on the left, the current regulations in dark blue in the middle, and the new proposed regulations in white on the right, as you go from left to right across the graphs. As you can see, we're far below the limits set in the current regulations. And in some cases, we're already meeting the tougher standard posed by the new rules. The current limits were set in 1997. And these were set after years of study by the EPA, industry, and environmental and scientific communities. These studies deemed that these levels in the regulations were deemed them to be safe for human health and the environment. And again, we're operating at fractions of these levels today. Since then, monitoring and detection technology has changed, and this challenges industry to make improvements in controls and scrubber technology. As such, the EPA's mandatory review of the standards has set the new limits even lower, as you can see by the slide. In some cases, these limits are so low, it challenges our ability of our instruments to detect them. For example, the new proposed limits on mercury are approximately 0.018 milligrams per dry standard cubic meter, or approximately 0.02 of a part per million. For a frame of reference, one part per million is like 30 seconds out of a year. For particulates, the number is 0.011 grains per dry standard cubic foot. A grain is 1/7,000th of a pound. For dioxin, it's really difficult to conceive how small these quantities are. The new regulation on dioxin, which we're already achieving by a large margin, is 9.3 nanograms per dry standard cubic meter, which is about 9 parts per trillion. A part per trillion is like 3 seconds out of every 100,000 years. Of course, some of the industry opponents out there say that no matter how small, is small enough. We just thought you should have some perspective on how small it is.
Could I get you to go back to your mercury?
Sure.
Just for a moment. And I'm just trying to get something clear in my mind. Okay. you show what you show, and this memo here states that that she gave us a copy of that. I guess it was to Diener, said that Sarah, in the 2010 stack test in regards to the mercury, it said that mercury levels are 10.5 times the new EPA standards. Now, how does that relate to what you've got there?
Well, as you can see on the right-hand side, the
2010
levels, that's correct.
That's correct.
The 2010 levels do not pass the new standard.
Right.
The 2009 levels did.
Okay, right? I got you. Okay.
We got some work to do there. If they pass the when they pass the new regulations.
So we're in agreement. On
when that. They put them in place, that's correct.
Okay.
We have to put in some additional equipment, and we have to perform better on a consistent basis.
Right. Now, one more point on that with that figure is, and they also mentioned lead, is it said the guy from Diener, she underlines that their calculations were correct on those two items. She didn't underline the other sentence that said he also found that those were the only two that were above the new standards. So my question is there is how many new standards are there? If you subtract out those two, how many did you pass?
Or? Well, the new standards take into account the three that we're showing here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. In addition to that, we're regulated for about four or five others. Mm-hmm. Okay. Some additional metals. Some additional acid gas requirements, and taken as a whole, no single plant in the country is achieving those limits today. None. Okay? That's why if those regulations were in place today, all of us would be out of compliance. Now, that doesn't mean we can't get there, and we intend to get there. And we'll talk a little bit more of that on the timeline slide that Celine's going to talk about next.
So, but you would say 80% of what you're monitoring for is better than the standard, right?
I wouldn't say 80%, and I'd have to look at each individual category to give you a figure.
But the vast majority.
Some of them were in compliance with, okay. Some of them were not. Some of them we have some work to do.
Okay.
Jim, let me ask you something. Is the...
Should I go back?
The emissions that's coming out of your stack go through your scrubbers. Is that what you're counting on to take all the emissions out of your exhaust?
Correct.
Okay. Okay.
Should I go for it?
Go ahead.
Okay. Lastly, we wanted to provide a timeline of the events that led us up to this point. And concerning the status of the regulations and Stericycle's efforts. As we've described, the regulations under Title V, the Clean Air Act, were first put in place in 1997, which caused about 98% of the incinerators to close. Most of these were small, rural, and hospital-based burners with little or no emission controls, and no doubt should have been closed. At this time, Stericycle started to amend its Paul River permit and upgrade the plant, and we had to be in compliance by 2002. Once the mandated compliance date was reached, many of the 2,500 incinerators, or over 2,500 incinerators that were in existence, had been shut down due to the sheer difficulty and cost of coming into compliance. Today, there's only 57 remaining, and a lot of those are starting to shut down, we're hearing about. And there are only 14 commercially operating facilities which provide services like ours. We received our new air permit at that time and continued to operate for the next several years. In 2006, we were required by the regulations to submit our five-year renewal, which is what is pending today. There were no proposed changes to the permit, simply a routine renewal, if you will, and since then, in 2007 and 2008, new emissions rules were proposed and subsequently promulgated in 2009. Currently, they're still in dispute in the D.C. court system today, but states like North Carolina have until this October to submit a plan which adopts these new rules with a plan for implementation, or alternatively to propose different rules which satisfy the minimum requirements under the Clean Air Act. The State Environmental Management Commission held a meeting regarding the adoption of the new rules last week. We're still waiting to hear what the results of that was. In the meantime, of course, communities like Graham and Alamance have been asked to consider moving up the timeline from implementation of the new rules from federal timeline of 2014 to 2012. We simply like to point out that there are a number of difficulties in implementing new emission limits. There's new equipment, as Jim mentioned, and processes that we have to research since there are no facilities today that can meet these requirements alone. We need to design, propose, and test for approved and consistent compliance. In addition, to permits to construct must be applied for and approved to add on this new equipment. Further, the reality is that most states, like North Carolina, have limited resources and are stretched to handle new programs and permits and regulations. And as such, there go a certain careful pace when dealing with these things. For example, our permit renewal has been in renewal status for 4 years. EPA certainly recognized these conditions when it set out the timetable in place for the 2014 deadline, as noted in the Federal Register, where it recommends that states give the full time allotted for these changes. While it's not up to a private company like Stericycle to make the laws, we certainly recognize the issues here before you. We are in a position of having to wait and see what the states decide to do on this, and our goal, as always, is to be in compliance with whatever laws and regulations are applicable to us when they become applicable. To attempt to get out in front of this legal process is like trying to hit a moving target. We hope that you will take this all into consideration when making your decision, such as passing a resolution which requests that the timetable for compliance is moved up by 2 years. This concludes our presentation, and on behalf of Stericycle, I'd like to thank you again for this opportunity to speak before you tonight, and at this time, I'd be happy to answer any further questions that the Commission may have.
I've only got one. How often does somebody from the feds or the state visit your site locally?
I don't recall when the last time someone from the federal level came, but we have at least annually the air inspectors in, and also I believe the solid waste department also comes in annually, and the city of Graham is there monthly.
Okay, and that's Raleigh and then Graham, right?
Okay. Yeah.
So what you're saying is they haven't give you any guidelines that you have to meet. Is that what you're saying?
There are federal regulations that were passed that are in place today.
Only since 2006. So you meeting what you had to do in 2006.
That's correct.
And they haven't given you the new guidelines. Is that
no.
Correct?
No.
Okay.
No, the permit pending before the state.
So they don't even
the
know
renewal.
Apparently. So
no.
They don't know what they want you to do.
Not yet.
Okay.
They'll know in October.
So you are in compliance.
Correct.
Okay, one question that did not come up here. We heard a lot about health issues. Talk to us about the health of your employees and the turnover rate of your employees.
That's a very good question. As I mentioned, we have about 55 employees now working out of the facility, and that number has grown throughout the years. But still, our average tenure of our employees is about 10 years that they've been working for us. So
10 years.
We have no ill health effects from our employees, no trends, no...
We've not seen any type of health conditions.
I mean, these guys work around this every single day.
Do y'all test them anyway?
Sure.
Yes, we do.
Hearing,
mm-hmm.
Along with everything else.
We do provide medical surveillance for our employees. Our maintenance workers, our drivers are required on per the DOT regulations, depending on where they fall, but they're required on a 1 or 2 or 3 year basis.
Okay.
I've got a couple questions. Go ahead. If you
all right, I've got I just want to say that I live close to Stericycle. I also grew up next to the Graham Waste Treatment Plant, which who knows what went into that chemical-wise. My brother worked there. He's in better health than anybody in this room, I promise you, and he's 72 years old. He has no problems whatsoever, no high blood pressure, no diabetes, no nothing. And he worked for the city of Graham in the waste treatment plant, which I used to could throw a rock to it, but my arms give out on me. but I also been living here all my life.
excuse me, and live about a mile from Stericycle. I have rarely seen the stacks when the steam came out of them, which a lot of people think it's smoke, but I understand it's mostly steam or...
Primarily water vapor.
Water vapor.
Correct.
But I just want to say that, you know, I feel like I'm for clean air, but you know the biggest pollutant in Alamance County is diesel. That is the number one pollutant. So what are we going to do? We're going to take the trucks off the road? I don't think so.
Build a bypass.
So, yeah, around it. But, you know, I just want to be fair to everybody, and I really am for clean air. But I just think that we need to give these people the time limit that the state and the federal government has given them to be in compliance with the new rules, which they don't even know what they are now, all of them. So it's my understanding. Am I right?
I'm talking to them.
I did look at you, but you could have just shook your head.
And I also want to say that the waste segregation was because of our organization.
Well, That's enough. But anyway.
Chairman, to answer your question about the regulations, they are published in the Federal Register. That is correct. They were published last October. That is a federal law, a federal rule. However, each state or local authority that has regulatory authority has to vote to adopt those regulations or write their own that will comply with the minimum standards in the Clean Air Act. The state of North Carolina has yet to act on that matter.
Okay.
Though that's who we're regulated by, the state of North Carolina.
Okay. Well, I just want to voice my opinion and say that I just feel like that we need to give them the time that they
Do y'all allowed. Test the bottom ash that comes?
Yes, we do.
Semi-annually, twice a year.
You say that went to Piedmont. Where is that?
Pierce near County.
Kernersville?
Person County.
Person.
What? Yeah. One of the gentlemen told me.
It's northwest of here, I guess.
Okay. Eddie?
I had a couple personal questions here.
Where are you from, Sam?
I live in Denver right now.
And
Jim? I live in St. Louis.
Okay. So of all the people that spoke here tonight, I didn't hear anybody come from your company saying we really are concerned or anything, or we're not concerned. I was just curious to that because we did have a lot of children speaking and folks speaking, and I know I'm pretty sure that most of these people are Alamance County residents. The little girl that spoke, Sedonia, whatever it was exactly, I touched with her because I have grandchildren. I have three that live within 5 miles of this thing. And to be honest, I'd never thought, as I rode down the interstate and I see these smokestacks blowing smoke out, I'd never thought about what is coming out of these smokestacks. I know the people around there have been very concerned about it for years, and I talked to my father-in-law coming over here, and they had a daughter that died at 40 years old, lived right down the road from it, from cancer. He said, you know, and I wonder if that could have been a cause. And I thought to myself, well, could it be? Well, like I said, I got three granddaughters who live within a five-mile radius. I got two that live in Hillsborough, which is about 12. As I make a decision tonight, I guess it's going to be a selfish one because I love them very much, and I am concerned. And if there's something you can do, because I read on your website, Stericycle is committed to protecting the environment, and you want to use your knowledge to develop the most environmentally friendly service for our customers. Well, be considerate of the people that live around you, too, is all I want to ask, because I think you mean that. And sometimes money is not an issue where life is. So if I don't know what comes out of there, and you hear a lot of data. You hear it from one side and the other.
Mm-hmm.
And if there is something you can spend money on to improve this, why wouldn't you?
So
you want to comment to me?
Was it a question?
I
mean,
I'm just saying, why wouldn't you?
We intend to.
We intend to.
Okay.
We do. The
question is not whether we're going to comply. The question is when.
And that's what's before you tonight. And for us, the question is, what are those limits exactly, so we can make that decision as to whether or not we can comply. So whether we're going to choose to continue to operate the facility or not. So that's, you know, we have to wait to see those things. We can't invest the money until we know what it is we're shooting for.
Okay.
And I understand.
I do too.
And I understand.
But I would encourage them to move up the timeline.
It sounds to me like the state and the federal government needs to get their act together and let y'all know what guidelines you have to operate by.
Well, and that's why
until they do that, you can't expect the company to spend money not knowing what they're to spend money on.
Okay. Any more?
I agree with both comments.
I do, but I just want to be fair to everybody. And like I said, I've been here all my life too, and I don't feel any repercussions from living at waste treatment plants and whatever. So,
well, I just feel like
thank you again for.
I feel that y'all have been in compliance all along. Is that correct? And it's hard to stay there.
We had our
no comments. I'm sorry. We are talking with them.
As we talked about during our presentation, we did have issues in 2004, and since then we've been in compliance.
And you were fined then, right?
That's correct.
And have you been fined in your other plants across the country?
There have been certain circumstances that we've had issues, but not that I can recall specifically here.
Okay. Maybe I read some stuff in Rhode Island different than what you did.
Which is not an incinerator facility.
Okay, this time I will open the floor for a motion.
Madam Chairman, before you get that motion, may I request that you provide the phone number and the emails that you said we could
have. Celine, will you give him the phone number?
Yes.
Could that be done publicly so that we all have that?
Sure.
Thank you.
She will do that.
Do you have a card?
Yes, and Madam Chairman, could you let us know, as the ex-mayor of Paw River, will you by any chance, the mayor, when this facility was first put in and or when Stericycle took over, as they said in the 90s?
No. I was not. I was on the board, but I was not. I was on the board in 1990.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
The best way to reach me would be 847-943-6685.
And your associate?
Well, Jim's.
Sure.
Can we also get an email? Because I think we all agree email's great.
Sure. Celine would be the prime.
You asked for telephone numbers. Now you want email.
No, I said email and telephone numbers, but whichever is possible, ma'am.
Okay.
That's fine. Celine would be the primary contact, and she's given her phone number. Her email address is shoboy at stericycle.com. Okay. My phone number is 618-781-6625. That's my direct line. And I can be reached at jnold@stericycle.com.
Thank you, sir.
Excuse me, Ms. Holborn, what's the area code for you? 847. 847-943-6685.
That's right.
That's right. Excuse me, commissioners, may I? I just need to point something out very quickly.
You're totally out of order.
This is very important, y'all.
You had your chance to speak two times.
We're in the business session.
What more do you want to say? Stericycle knows, what I want to say is Stericycle knows that there are new federal limits, and the limits have been set, and they have to at least meet the federal limits. And the state can impose stricter guidelines. That is what I want to say.
That is
what I said.
I think that's what we did say.
Okay, at this time, I will have opened the floor for a motion.
I'll make a motion that we accept this resolution and send it forward to the state.
Okay, I have a motion on the floor.
Well, I'm not going to second it, but I'd like to say something if I may.
Okay.
First of all, when we're asked to pass a resolution, I think it's abundantly clear that our duties are to weigh it, make sure that we're not placating a situation, make sure that it's warranted, not do it on emotion, do it on the best presentation of facts that are available. I understand everybody's feelings. I've had people in my family die of cancer, too. But I certainly didn't think it was somebody else's fault. But maybe a misdiagnosis, I will say that. And no offense to Mr. Boswell, but I do take somewhat exception of you pointing out where they're from, as if their testimony might have been less concerning to us as Americans because they were from other areas. I was very impressed by their presentation.
They did do a good job, but impressed. I thought it was very important to note where they're
the
from.
Fact that one's from another part of the United States and another one lives in St. Louis has no bearing on what impresses me and or not. as a matter of fact, I expect it was more academic than we might have gotten otherwise. And that's what I'm after. And I can't vote on resolutions that are motion more than it's academic. Now, to me, if you've got a federal agency that's academically allowing them parameters, and if you've got state agencies that are allowing them licensing parameters, I'm willing to honor that and not go on emotion, right or wrong, as to what people want. So I cannot support the resolution. And
with all due respect to that, Tim, the building industry just recently has been imposed with a regulation on lead removal. And you're going to have to be trained, taught in that. This is something just come overnight. And just because the EPA has not recognized this yet doesn't mean tomorrow they will not.
Very possible.
All I'm saying is if this could be moved up 2 years for them to implement something that they can do,
mm-hmm.
I'm going to have a problem with them not.
Well, if the EPA tells them, I expect they'll do it.
And I'm sure they will.
Okay.
And well, I'm just saying it's encouraging.
Do you think they're going to?
I can't second guess that one.
I've never known them to be soft on anybody, but
okay. I agree with that.
Well, I don't have a second on that motion. Do I hear another motion?
Well, what would it be? That we don't do the resolution?
Yes, sir. That we do not accept this resolution.
If I was on a jury trying to decide somebody's guilt or innocence based on what I've been presented, and based on what expert testimony that we know's out there from the agencies, I would have to vote innocence, because it's not beyond a shadow of doubt for me. So, and that's my duty as a commissioner. And if it offends somebody, I apologize. But that's the way I would hope you would want your case weighed if you came before me personally. Proof versus emotions.
If there's no second, I call for the question. There's nothing to discuss. I think it's as far as.
Well, if we have to make a motion not to do a resolution, I will make that motion.
Okay, I have a motion not to accept the resolution.
I'd like to second it, but I'd like to make a comment. We've heard so many times about Stericycle and what they've done, had done, are doing. I think it is, as elected officials, that you need to hear and go see both sides of a situation. I think that's your duty. And this is what many of us did. I don't know if all of us went out, but many of us did go out at different times, toured the plant, heard the presentation. It was much more than what you heard today. And form your own opinion. And this is what we've done. And I will second that.
And I will make one more comment. You know, the city of Burlington and the city of Graham are told that they've got to do all this retrofitting. And they have how many years? 5 years to get this retrofitting done.
That's correct.
If the state come back and told them they had to have it done in a year, your water rates would quadruple or whatever. So I think it's on, and that's part of my problem with not giving these people enough time to do what they have been allowed to do. So that is part of my problem with this resolution, is that they have been allowed till 2014, just like Burlington and Graham has been allowed to have their waste treatment plants upgraded by 2015, which is multi-millions of dollars. So that is the reason that I can't support it either. So at this point, all in favor of not supporting this resolution, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed?
Aye.
Okay. All right. Well, not really.
Now, I called the Stair Cycle twice last Thursday to try to arrange for some of our group to go through their plant, and they never returned my calls. I called twice.
To call the right number, because I don't even have that right.
Yes, I talked to them.
Yeah. If you would just wait, and Celine will go out and talk with you about that, if you don't mind, because I don't have any place over there. Okay, next is a...
Madam Chair, I'd like to ask for a 5-minute recess, if you don't mind.
All right. We will recess for 5 minutes, no problem.
Need to stretch your legs.
Thank you, ma'am.
Remember what happened last week?